So if you look at the announcement video for Ant-Man and the Wasp going into production, does it remind you of anything? I don't know, maybe The Incredibles? Now that I've said it, you can't unsee it because it's so totally true, from the music to the logo. And it makes perfect sense because not only was the first film a family film, but it seems that the sequel is going to be even more of a family adventure. You had your chance, Fantastic Four, to fill the slot, the live action slot that you so obviously were supposed to, because The Incredibles is largely based off the Fantastic Four, many of us believe. But you know what? The Fantastic Four are still stuck over at Fox, and this is all under the Disney umbrella. And hey, it looks like the Pims are gonna be the new Incredibles. Or is that the Pims hyphen Van Dynes? That's a mouthful. Hopefully Hank will apologize to Janet and his daughter Hope, and they can go back to just being the Pims. But anyway, clearly, the casting of not only legendary actress, but comic book movie icon Michelle Pfeiffer as Janet Van Dyne means the odds are pretty good that the mission that the Pims need Scott Lang for, according to the synopsis for this sequel, is to rescue Mama Pym. And if they can reach out to Lang, by the way, perhaps he's no longer a fugitive after Infinity War. Very interesting. But anyway, while the announcement video features two tiny chairs, Comic-Con this year actually confirmed that Giant Man will feature heavily in the movie, and that we're getting two of them, or at least we're on our way to two of them, as Laurence Fishburne is joining the film as Dr. Bill Foster, aka Goliath. So let's talk new characters and the actors who will play them, as clearly the world of Ant-Man is expanding rather than shrinking. And be sure to comment down below how you feel about this movie and these additions, because I'll be picking one comment from a BTC subscriber. You have to be a subscriber to qualify to win Beyond the Trailer's Movie a Day giveaway, where you will get a $30 AMC gift card sponsored by Broadband TV. This is happening every weekday on new videos here on Beyond the Trailer through August 23rd, so be sure to subscribe and be sure to comment. All right, so Michelle Pfeiffer as Janet Van Dyne. Unbelievably, she's never worked with Michael Douglas before. Al Pacino a whole bunch, never Michael Douglas. But she has gone brunette once or twice, and that's a big question. If this famous blonde will don Janet Van Dyne's famous brunette pixie cut, or is that wasp cut? Can't help myself. She does have very small, like cute little features. And an even bigger question though, is whether or not Pfeiffer can possibly recreate the magic of her comic book role, Catwoman, way back in 1992 in Batman Returns. Still the most famous depiction of the character though, because really, who's going to top this? Can Michelle Pfeiffer even top it, or ideally create something totally different? Janet Van Dyne is a really important character. You'd never know it from her representation in the comics today, but she's not only the first female Avenger, but she was a founding member of the team. Sure, she got in because she was Giant Man's wife at the time, but hey, tomato, tomato. During that period, that was considered progress for women. And she's getting into this movie as someone's, as Hank Pym's wife once again. But anyway, she clearly deserves an iconic performance, and Michelle Pfeiffer certainly can deliver one, or at least she could. She's been a little low on iconic these days recently. She seemed pretty bad, actually, in the trailer for The Orient Express. But here's hoping she has untapped reserves that want to come out again. Now, for those of you unfamiliar with the Wasp, she was showcased quite nicely in the recent animated series, but that didn't last, unfortunately. She can shrink down, and she can fly, just like you're going to see Hope do. Now, here, at least with Hope, it seems that her wings are technological. But in the comics, and in other mediums when she's been interpreted there, Janet, her mom, had biological wings that were genetically manipulated or created by her husband. She can also emit bio. It's interesting. I wonder which of these powers will go to Hope, which will go to Janet, how much they'll share. We'll see. And there are other people who have been the Wasp over the years, but you know, Janet, of course, is the original. But anyway, she has bioelectric blasts, which are basically her wasp sting. Get it? Just like Black Widow's sting. Although, again, technological versus, genetically engineered. We'll see what route we're going down. Speaking of genetic engineering, you're going to see that come into a little bit with the villains here, the potential villains for this movie. So the Pym industry could be getting into healthcare tech. But also, she's gone big a couple times herself. This is a big one, pun intended, but Janet Van Dyne tragically died during Secret Invasion when she was big. And interestingly enough, it seems the MCU might be setting up Secret Invasion as Captain Marvel is set in the 1990s. You can check out my video on that theory by the link down below or the annotation at the end of this video. Now, what happened? Tragic story short, Hank Pym was being impersonated by a Skrull. So when he went to give his ex-wife, but fellow Avenger, Janet Van Dyne, a new batch of Pym particles, you know, she felt it was just a regular trip to the superhero doctor, he actually turned her into a biobomb, a ticking biobomb that went off when she enlarged herself mid-battle. Now, Janet very heroically sacrificed herself, trying to take as many Skrulls with her as she could, and everyone thought she died. But actually what happened was that the explosion shunted her into the microverse, which interestingly is where I believe we're going to be finding her in the sequel. Don't let anyone inject you with anything in the MCU, Janet. You could be turned into a biobomb. All right, so anyway, in fact, going big does seem reasonably to put a pretty big target on you because Laurence Fishburne's Goliath also died on the battlefield during Civil War. Stay away from Thor, Laurence Fishburne. And I'm sure that Laurence Fishburne, by the way, is glad they've already filmed the Civil War storyline. But he could always die another time. This is another DC actor like Pfeiffer, by the way, going over to Marvel. But I think here, can you blame him? It is a bigger role. In the comics, Hank Pym hires Dr. Bill Foster away from Tony Stark, which I could totally see happening in this movie because of the bad blood that exists between those families in the MCU. Dr. Foster eventually succeeded Hank Pym as Giant Man before striking out on his own to establish his own identity as Black Goliath because, hey, it was the 1970s. He eventually just became Goliath, though, and then again, once again, perished during Civil War. He does have a son, Tom Foster, who took over the Goliath mantle after his father was killed. And considering the Ant-Man movies focus on family, don't be surprised if young Tom pops up somewhere in the sequel, even just for a moment, as a sign of things to come. So is this just a rescue mission for the sequel, or are we gonna fight someone? The MCU is getting better at villains. And they've enlisted, for this new movie, professional villain Walton Goggins to play Sonny Burch. He's gonna be the new villain, for instance, in Tomb Raider. But this is an interesting character in Ant-Man mythology. He worked, in the comics, he worked for cross-technological enterprises. So basically, he is the Pym's very own Justin Hammer, complete with big hair and big teeth. Another tech guy, but listen, trust me, it gets interesting. Not only does Burch have political aspirations in the comics, but he also has a bit of a comedic touch to him because he's infamous for never understanding any of the tech he has to represent. So that could be funny. And Walton Goggins is a very funny guy. Although I really liked Sam Rockwell as Justin Hammer. I feel bad that he never came back. That's a bit with the bronzer. Was golden. Haha! Oh, so many puns in this video. All right, so anyway, his boss, Darren Cross, is obviously someone you've already met in the MCU and said goodbye to, which means that Cross's storyline from the comics is available and will likely go to Sonny Burch. And it's a good one! So Corey Stoll actually got the tiny end of the stick here. So anyway, what happened to Darren Cross in the comics? Well, Cross discovers that he has a heart condition, and he's able to come up with a pacemaker through his company, but the problem is that it burns through his heart very quickly, which requires him to have a constant supply of new hearts. And you know what? When you need that many hearts that quickly, you can't really get them legit. So he has to go out and get donors. And in the comics, one such donor is Scott Lang's daughter, Cassie. Now, I think in the movies, in the MCU, her heart's probably a little too small for Walton Goggins right now. But don't be surprised if they either use this storyline and they go after someone else's heart, or they put Cassie on a collision course with this company maybe at some point in the future. And with all the businesses, speaking of businesses in the MCU, it's high time we got ourselves someone specializing in corporate espionage. I love corporate espionage. I don't think it gets enough credit as being an exciting career path and for stories. But that would be Ghost. This is great. A former IT researcher whose ghost tech, which basically makes things go kitty pride, is stolen by the company that he works for. To exact his revenge, he uses his ghost tech on himself, but then, as is always the way with comic books, an explosion causes the upgrade to be permanent. Ghost can eventually not only go intangible, but also invisible, and of course, is a skilled hacker. And in the, Ant-Man and the Wasp, a dude looks like a lady. This should be an interesting character. We'll see if we get full-blown Ghost or just the beginnings of Ghost in the sequel. Then finally, this is important, comedian Randall Park has gotten a big gig after a lot of really great small gigs, and that's his S.H.I.E.L.D. agent Jimmy Woo. But while Park is undeniably hilarious and we're all rooting for him, one has to wonder if this character will get the respect it deserves as one of Marvel's first and only Asian heroes. In the comics, actually, Woo is famous in some circles, unfortunately just in some circles, as one of the few, also again, few positive portrayals of Asian Americans. And he was a cool James Bond type character when he first came on the scene. Now, of course, Ant-Man and the Wasp is going to be a comedy just like the first movie. And I'm sure it's going to be a great comedy. A lot of the people here are very skilled comedians, as is Park. But let's hope that his agent Woo is the one making the jokes rather than being the punchline. So those are the new characters and actors joining this sequel. Again, be sure to share your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.